In this video, I want to help you understand what happens in your body when you do various types of exercise. For example, I will show you what happens to the hormones, calories, and heart rate in my body when I do 4 types of exercises. In this video, we will also answer questions like, what exercises will make me less hungry so I can avoid eating all the calories back that I lost from working out? Or what kind of exercise will deplete my testosterone and which won't? Why do I not lose weight even though I've been working out consistently? If I work out twice as hard, do I burn twice as many calories? Then at the end of this video, I will sum up which type of workout will better suit your needs. So to do all this, I hook myself up to a heart rate monitor and this Garmin watch, which records my whole entire workouts. I also have my blood drawn before and 15 minutes after each workout so you can see how my hormones change in conjunction with each type of workout. Then I also hook myself up to this blood sugar monitor, which measures my blood glucose levels in real time as I'm working out. Then I do 4 types of exercises so you can see the differences of each of these things for each different type of exercise. First, let's look at my pace and calories. And you can see I went to work out on May 1st at 9:24, and I worked out for about 38 minutes. And this is the same for all 4 of my workouts, as you will see. Now, on this workout, my pace is a very slow 15 minute and 29 second mile. That is a very, very light jog, as you can see. You can almost consider it something in between the pace of a fast walk and a jog. At this pace, I ran only 2.46 miles within that 38 minutes. But what you may be surprised to learn is that for me, that actually burns about 508 calories, which is actually pretty good for working out 38 minutes. If you want to know how much 508 calories is, that is a little less than a Big Mac at McDonald's. Now on May 4th, I go on another run for my second workout. Now from this readout, you can tell my pace is a 10 minute and 30 second mile, which is a steady jog. Now compared to my first workout, that's a third of the pace faster. So basic logic would tell you that you probably burn a third more calories, right? And as you can see, I likely only burned about 66 calories more. Now let's go on to my exercise on workout 3. In this workout, you can see the first 28 minutes, my pace is like my first workout, around 15 minutes and 30 second mile of a pace. But like I said, this is a hybrid workout. At the end of this graph, you can see these 4 peaks. This is where I did sprints. Now, not only did I do sprints at this moment, I did sprints as though my life depended on it. That is how fast my pace was, until I hit that metaphorical wall when I had to stop running. Now I ran 2.58 miles, and that's almost a 15 minute pace because the first 28 minutes I ran just like the first workout at a 15 minute and 30 second pace, and at the end I really picked up the pace for those sprints even though I walked in between. The calories burned is about the same in this workout as my first workout. Now, while I may not have burned more calories, you'll see the benefits of this style of run later as we get into more of the hormones. Now, lastly, on my last workout, I ran almost a 9 minute mile pace for a little over 4 miles on my last and 4th workout. Now, this feels like 30 times the effort as my first workout where I was barely even jogging, but still, it only burned 135 calories more than that workout, even though I was doing what felt like 30 times the effort, in my opinion. That amount of calories is less than a small fry at McDonald's. So, doing that workout, you can't be more hungry than a small fry's worth of calories. So you can see all 4 workouts, there's not a big difference in calories when comparing them to food, as I have done. There's just not that much. Extra effort may not be worth it, and we're gonna see that it probably isn't for a lot of people when we start looking at the hormones. And to understand that and much more, let's move into the heart rate and VO2 max. Now, When I ran at those paces, it wasn't because I was actually tracking my pace. I was really tracking my heart rate and something called the VO2 max. Why track these? When we track the heart rate and VO2 max, it tells us a lot about the rest of everything else going on in our bodies, like our hormone levels, which we will cover in just a moment. So for example, for my first workout, I am running and I'm constantly checking my specific Garmin watch, making sure I am in zone 3. Zone 3 is an aerobic exercise. So this exercise means it's an exercise that needs air. So let me explain further. Your body has different systems to make energy. Its most efficient system requires oxygen. So that is why your oxygen picks up when you run. Since my first workout was mostly in the aerobic zone, it was so slow and not intense that my body could get all its energy from its most efficient system, its aerobic system that runs purely with the system that uses oxygen. So examples of aerobic workouts are things like light jogs, light rowing, and exercise that you can do and still have a full conversation at the same time without panting for air. Now here you can see my second workout was an anaerobic workout because my heart rate averaged in that zone 4. And here you can see I was most of the time in the borderline of zone 4 and zone 5. My workout required more energy that could be provided by solely the aerobic system alone. It started using a system to create energy that was less efficient called anaerobics. These workouts are things as simple as jogging and biking at 3/4 your maximum speed, and anything that is more intense than that. I want to skip workout 3 for just 1 second because workout 3 was a hybrid of different types of workout. Workout 4 was in zone 5 mostly the whole time I was working out, and it was pushing my heart to the limit for the whole 38 minutes that I was running. So the more you push your workout, the more your body uses anaerobic methods of getting energy. This workout is called cardio or high intensity training, but you may know it as something like boot camp, spin class, even soccer and basketball games, Orange Theory workouts, and even aerobics classes, like I said, they are a misnomer. Now, the first part of workout 3 was aerobic, as you can tell by my pace and my heart rate. But the last part where I sprinted is something called high intensity interval training. Emphasis on the interval. This workout is so intense, you have to stop and rest between sets because you're pushing yourself too much. These are things like sprints, weightlifting, burpees, biking on hills, so on and so forth. So now that you know the different workout levels, you are ready to learn the differences in hormones that happen in your body in response to these workouts. And that is why the workout levels are so important to cover, because there is going to be a difference in what happens with all of these. Blood sugar or glucose. As you can see, when I am running, I have this little device that reads a blood sugar patch on my arm. I can measure my glucose in real time and know what my blood sugar is at each moment, even during my run, and you will see that is exactly what I did. After my workout, it all shows up on this readout that I'm going to place right before you now. So you can understand this chart, this column right here has my blood glucose levels during all the times I took my blood glucose during this run. And this one at the beginning is where my blood sugar starts right before my workout. And then the rest of the numbers are in chronological order of when I took the readouts during my run. So why am I measuring glucose in the first place during my workout? All life forms use glucose for energy, including humans. Now remember how I explained there were different systems to produce energy and how one system uses air and others don't? Well, both of those systems require glucose. So whether you use air or not, your body needs glucose to burn energy. When your body uses glucose combined with air, it gets about 36 to 38 ATPs, and ATPs are your body's energy molecules. But if your body does not use oxygen to combust glucose, it only gets about 2 energy molecules. So every time your body runs its aerobic system, it gets 36 to 38 energy units, and it only gets 2 if it uses its anaerobic system. Do you see why your body wants air so bad? So if you're doing a heavy workout, your body needs to be flooded with glucose to create enough energy to finish that workout. Now that brings us to my stats. When I start my aerobic workout, number one, you can see my glucose starts at 75 units. Now my body immediately realizes it needs energy to finish this workout, and thus it needs more glucose to produce that energy. So the glucose rises in my blood, and you can see that here in the rest of the numbers in this column. It rises to the 80s for almost the entirety of the run. In anaerobic workout number 2, let's look at that. You can see I start in the high 70s once again, like I started in the first workout. My blood sugar quickly goes up to the 80s. Now, as I am running, I start to feel really good. So I take my blood sugar at that moment when I feel like I can run forever. And that point is right here when my blood sugar peaks at 95 units. That's right. When you are feeling good on your run, it's that spike in glucose that gets you feeling good. Apart from that, you can tell my body is releasing so much glucose because it needs energy, and it is now running its inefficient energy system because this is workout number 2, the anaerobic workout. So it needs to be pumping so much glucose because it's only getting 2 energy units for every glucose molecule that it has. It then peaks again a second time in the workout to 97 units. And you can still see it's even peaking after my workout at about 100 units. Now, that moves us on to workout number 3. I start workout number 3 at around 66 units. I just naturally have low blood sugar. So as soon as I start my workout, I think my body realizes it's really low on glucose to be working out. And it immediately goes up because it needs energy for this run. Now, something to realize when we move on to the last 10 minutes when I start doing sprints is that your body can take a little bit of time to get what it needs. When I start doing my sprints, my glucose drops to 73 units. So my body is using the glucose, but not yet producing enough to keep up with the energy it needs for these sprints. So my cells are sucking that glucose out, and my glucose is dropping in my blood. Your body realizes this, but it doesn't get that flood of glucose to my blood until 10 to 15 minutes after my workout. So it starts the process when it notices my blood sugar is dropping, and then it finishes it 10 to 15 minutes after my workout. And there you can see that glucose starts to build up in my blood really fast because my cells don't really need it that much anymore. But you don't have to worry too much because your body always realizes these imbalances. So eventually it takes that sugar that is extra in your blood and puts it back into the cells that need it to store it if they don't need it. So now let's look at the blood sugar for my cardio or my workout number 4. You can see my body quickly notices it needs a lot of glucose with how much anaerobic energy it is burning because I am running. Remember, I'm running at this point. So my glucose rises and stays in the 90s and into the 100s for most of the workout. Okay, so great. What does this all mean now that you have this energy? Well, there are hormones that regulate this whole process of producing and pushing glucose into your blood. But those hormones don't just regulate the energy process. In fact, they do things that are very important for your weight gain, your weight loss, your metabolic rate, and so many other things. So let's get into that now. And let's start with cortisol. For those that don't know what cortisol is released when your sympathetic or fight or flight nervous system starts. When cortisol is released, it travels and tells your liver to push glucose in your blood. So that is the signal that pushes the glucose to your blood. The thing is, it does a lot more than just what it does during your exercise to push glucose into your blood. So that being said, cortisol is also something that is released when you're stressed out. Now, your body does not like stress. It remembers where stress comes from and tries to avoid activities that produce a lot of cortisol or stress. So the more cortisol is released into the blood during exercise, the more your subconscious will try and avoid whatever that exercise is in the future. Thus, it takes a lot more discipline and motivation to continue doing that exercise in the future if it's producing lots of cortisol. When cortisol and something called insulin are released, it produces an increased amount of hunger as well. And we will get into insulin in just a moment. But suffice it to say, if you are trying to lose weight, you do not want to eat the calories back. And there are some exercises that I did that will increase your cortisol a lot. My aerobic workout was not one of those. It did not need a lot of glucose, as we saw. My cortisol started around 17.5 units, and 15 minutes after my workout ended, it was at 10.5 units. So in other words, in total, I had no net gain in cortisol, and the cortisol I had on hand was sufficient to release the glucose I needed to finish my workout. So that is why it decreased, and there was no increase. I had sufficient amount of cortisol on hand. In workout two, I started at 13 units. Only this time, I only dropped about 2.5 units through my workout. So I had to start producing cortisol, not enough that surpassed my starting level, but I obviously was producing some because it didn't drop as much as it did in workout number one. My third workout is interesting. This workout, I started at about 10.7 units, but I ended with 16.5 units of cortisol. So about a net gain of 6 units in cortisol. My guess is this number might be a little bit skewed because remember, the spike I had in sugar happened after my workout. And so therefore, all this cortisol was being produced after my workout, right when I was having my blood sugar taken. So naturally, it's going to be a little bit higher if this is when it's releasing all the glucose into my blood. But my guess is if we could look at the total cortisol release during this workout, it probably would have been closer to that of workout number two. And I will show you why I think that in just a little bit. Lastly, workout four started at 13.6 units and ended at 22.7 units. A net gain in 9 units of cortisol. Now this gain is likely due to the fact that I needed more cortisol to get more glucose to the very high demand that this anaerobic and cardio workout needs in energy. So if you want a workout plan that is gonna work for you long term, meaning the rest of your life, this might not be the style of workout for you. Workout four will have your body saying to you, you don't need to work out. You need to sleep. You need to watch your favorite show or any other excuse. Because remember, that cortisol is going to be remembered by your body where it came from, and it's going to do whatever it can to avoid that stress that produced that cortisol. The other workouts, especially the first workout, it's not likely to do that because your cortisol wasn't released so high. So having a sustainable workout is going to be easier because your body isn't going to be fighting against that need or that desire to not have spikes in cortisol. Now let's move on to testosterone. The reason we measure testosterone is because it promotes muscle building. So it is something that is released during exercise, telling your body, hey, we need to start building muscle in case this ever happens again. However, endurance training like running normally reduces testosterone. And females, you need testosterone too. So low testosterone may not be what you want because low testosterone causes fatigue, depression, irritability, and loss of libido. Now, testosterone levels will also tell us two other things. The first thing it tells us is, was the exercise intense enough to send messages to build future muscle? The second thing it helps us, and this isn't exact, but it helps give us clues as to what the actual production level of cortisol was. Now, what's interesting in all of this is cortisol and testosterone have this inverse relationship. So if exercise increases cortisol, it decreases testosterone and vice versa. Both of these hormones are made from cholesterol. And therefore, your body only has so much cholesterol on hand, so it has to decide whether it wants to create more testosterone or more cortisol. And so you can see they're kind of in competition with each other. So now remember, going back to workout number three, this is how I know more about the whole picture of my cortisol, because I can take the whole picture of my testosterone and kind of infer how much total cortisol was produced on my workout as well. So, workout number one, my testosterone starts at 571 units. After my workout, my testosterone is at 530 units. So a decrease in testosterone tells me my body did produce a little bit of cortisol on this run, even though the net cortisol was lower. And also, it tells me that my body is getting signals that there's no need to lay down new muscle for this type of a workout. So now the same thing with workout number two. My testosterone starts at 561 units and ends at 443. So this is a 120 point drop. This is terrible for testosterone levels. So this tells us two things. Once again, that my body actually did produce some cortisol during that workout, even though I had a net loss of cortisol. And it also tells us there's no real need to lay down new muscle for these kinds of workouts. However, workout number three, I started at 473 units and ended slightly higher at 475 units. So anyway, my testosterone likely decreased for the first 30 minutes of the aerobic workout, but the high intensity interval training sent signals to my body that this exercise will require more muscle in the future. So it started producing more testosterone to almost surpass its beginning level. This is also why I was able to say the blood level of cortisol was probably misleading for workout number three, as it was taken during the peak of my cortisol production after my workout. Because theoretically, my cortisol would have been really low if testosterone were this high in comparison to the other workouts. Lastly, we have workout number four, which we know already produced a ton of cortisol. My testosterone that day started actually pretty high at 675 units. Now, possibly this high starting point might be due to the fact that my last workout is telling my body to still produce more testosterone. Who knows though? But it decreased to 590 units by the end of my workout. Now you would think that this would drop further because of so much cortisol being produced, but there is likely a little bit of signaling as well that there needs to be muscle growth because of the high demand that's put on the muscles. For these reasons is why I recommend workout number three. It is a great combination of burning calories, plus you can tell you're getting muscle growth and it doesn't stress your body out, and therefore it's more sustainable. But now let's move on to growth hormone. Speaking of muscle growth, growth hormone or GH levels are a better predictor of muscle growth. In fact, growth hormone signals the growth of most tissues, not just muscles. It also does brain cells, bones, and many other tissues. Growth hormone also tells us how much fat we are going to break down from each workout. So the higher the GH, the more fat your body wants to break down. It also tells us a lot about our metabolic rate. Your resting metabolic rate is how many calories your body burns while at rest doing nothing. So if you get any increase in your metabolic rate, life in general is just burning more calories. Growth hormone also may have some anti-aging properties. So you want to naturally increase growth hormone as much as possible. Now there is a caveat to that, but let's first look at our workouts. Workout one has an increase of 2.9 of a starting growth hormone to 6.8. So an increase in 4 units. Workout two, it increased from 0.2 units to 11.4 units. So that was an 11 unit increase. Understandable because it was more of a muscle demand on your body. Workout three was a jump from 2.1 units to 11.8 units. So almost a 10 point jump. Pretty good since it was pretty much the same as workout number one, only we got an additional 6 units of growth hormone by simply adding 4 sprints to the entire workout. That is the beauty of high intensity interval training. You get maximum hormone benefit from just a little bit of working out. Okay, but now for the beauty of workout number four. I started at 0.1 unit that day, and I ended at 20 units after the workout. That is insane. But before you rush to this kind of workout because it increases your growth hormone 20 units, remember, it comes at a few costs. One of them being cortisol, and the other is an increase in hunger, which leads me to the next hormone, which is insulin. Now, I didn't test my insulin because as you can see, insulin normally peaks 15 minutes after cortisol, and the blood draw facility wouldn't let me just sit there for 15 minutes because they had money to make with other patients. So let me explain more about insulin and what it does before I get into the levels. Let's say a muscle cell needs glucose for energy. Let's pretend it's a muscle cell. So in essence, what that muscle cell does is it raises a flag on its surface signaling that it needs insulin. So insulin sees that flag, and what it does is it goes and attaches to that cell and opens a gate to let the glucose into that cell to produce energy for that specific muscle cell. If your cell doesn't need energy, it doesn't raise the flag and the insulin moves right past. So remember, insulin binds to muscle cells and fat cells, telling them both they need to take glucose in. But if your muscle cells don't need it, they get moved to the fat cells. So you can see insulin is the gatekeeper here, but it has a few other things it does too, and I've already pointed one of those out. One thing insulin does is it controls hunger, and it does this in conjunction with other hunger hormones. Now, insulin's role is very interesting. What it does is it shuts down the nerves that tell you you're satisfied. The more you have of insulin, the more it completely shuts these nerves and this signal down. Therefore, if you have lots of insulin, any little signal of hunger completely tips the scale to tell you that you are hungry. Every hormone normally has different roles. Insulin, while it's the gatekeeper and moves glucose to where it needs to be, it also gives your brain hunger signals, or should I say, lack of signals that you're satisfied or satiated, and so therefore, it makes you more hungry. We can more or less infer the more cortisol that we produce, the more insulin we also produce, because once that glucose is released into the blood, we need that insulin to tell us where it goes as well, which also means the more hungry you will be, once again, just to hit that home. This study shows that it lowers your quality of life by making you just generally more irritable and gives you a bunch of negative emotions. So while an intense workout may make you feel better in the short term, it doesn't do that in the long term, which is why many people that work out and aren't eating a lot are super grumpy. So you can go back and just look at the cortisol readings that I have, and you can generally figure out what my insulin levels are gonna be as well. Now, remember I mentioned there were a couple hunger hormones. There's another one called ghrelin. Ghrelin is one of the many hunger hormones, and it is one of the main 3 hunger hormones, and most think it's the main one. Most studies show slight variances and increases in ghrelin when doing exercise depending on your obesity level. The more obese you are, the more hunger hormone is produced in response to your exercise. It seems to be that this slight increase in ghrelin that turns on your hunger pathway from exercise and the increased insulin that turns off certain nerves that tell you you are satiated that make us eat more than we burn when we are exercising. And that is why some people cannot lose weight during exercise. They are eating it all back. Now, all these hormones are affected more than just exercise, but this is what exercise is doing to these hormone levels. And there are more videos that I'm gonna make on how eating incorrectly affects these as well. So now let's get into which exercise is right for you. True aerobic workouts, like workout number one, are best if you solely want to lose weight. It burns calories and doesn't make you want to eat them back. It is more sustainable in that it doesn't require as much discipline to overcome the small amounts of stress hormones that it produces to demotivate you. Also, from your hormones, we learned that it will have a little effect on your mood as it will produce slightly less testosterone. So, it is not good for muscle building and testosterone levels as well if that's something you're looking to increase. Light anaerobic workouts like workout number two, I really don't recommend that much because you can get most of its benefits from workout number three with just a few of its drawbacks. So with workout number two, you produce cortisol over a long period of time, which is demotivating, it makes you hungry, lowers your testosterone a lot, and doesn't build much muscle and burns only slightly more calories than workout number one. Workout number three is my favorite for most people. If you aren't trying to lose weight, you get all the hormonal benefits very quickly, so workouts are fast and time-saving. If you do want to lose weight, you add in the aerobic part of the workout, like I did. This workout keeps your mood up by producing testosterone and not a lot of insulin, which also makes you way less hungry. Also, the less time you produce cortisol, the better on your mood and hunger and the sustainability of your workout program. You get a lot of the benefits of growth hormone as well, which is great for your resting metabolic rates and all the benefits that come from growth hormone. Now, why would you want to do workout number four? Remember, workout four is the cardio or high intensity training, not high intensity interval. It is great for certain types of people, mainly athletes. In short, to do this workout, you will need the time and the willpower to do it effectively. For most people, it isn't sustainable long-term and very demotivating, especially if they are just trying to lose weight. Look, I love proving health on my own body by doing experiments, so you can apply it to yourself in your life. I love making health, travel, and home automation videos. My videos are always mind-blowing and never waste your time. So like, subscribe, and I will see you in the next one.